السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As I said last night, the situation in Iraq has got much to cause worries for us all and anxiety. And we still do not know about the whereabouts and situation of our mujtahid, Ayatullah al-Azama, Abu Qasim al-Khoi, hafizahullah. Rumors say that he is in Baghdad. Some say that he has been returned to Najaf, but we do not have any concern for him. We pray that Allah may keep him safe, together with his family and all the ulama who are under apprehension for the time. In the meantime, as you must have seen and heard and read, certain parts of Iraq have been retaken by the forces of Saddam. And therefore, it is causing anxiety. But inshallah ta'ala, we hope that the victory finally is of Islam. In the meantime, Ayatollah Khamenei has already ordered certain Iranian troops on alert on the border dividing Iran and Iraq. The allied forces within Iraq are there, and under their very nose, the Muslims are being massacred day and night. And what Quran and Majid has said stands totally vivid and correct even today, that you cannot expect, O mu'mineen, O believers, you cannot expect any friendship, any sympathy from those who have no belief in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Be very careful, therefore, in extending the hand of friendship to those who have no soft corner and no sympathy for you. They would rather have you massacred. And I said it earlier, that the enmity is with Islam. The rest of all is just to show the world. And there has been a pre-planned order, the order which will not allow Islamic resurgence and revival to form an Islamic bloc spreading from Iran over to Iraq. This is what the world of kufr does not like to see. And we are being victimized because of that. That is the reason why we pray every day. And I think this dua of iftitah, which you have read and all of us have read, was taught by Imam Zaman, ajjalallahu farajah salamu alayhi, which ends, as we know, says, Allahumma inna nashku ilayka faqda nabiyyina salawatuka alayhi wa alihi wa ghaybata waliyyina wa kathrata aduwina wa qillata adadina wa shiddata alfitani bina wa tazahura alzamani alayhi. O Allah, the only complaint we have is that the Prophet is not among us, and our Wali and Imam at the moment is in concealment. The whole world is against us. We are few in number, and the demonstration against us is overwhelmingly more and is on the increase. This was the dua that has been taught by Imam al-Islam, perhaps for these days in which we are living. But anyway, dua is one of the things. In Dua-e Kumail, the last line is, O God, forgive him who has nothing. La yamliku illa raja. He doesn't have anything in possession but hope. Wasilahuhul bukha. And the weapon that he has is to weep and beseech and implore, Ya Allah, come to the rescue of Ummah. That is dua that we have got to read together with much of activity that is required of us, which we shall be discussing in the nights to come. In any way, in response to the appeal that was made, I have told you that the first sum that I received was £3,300, which has been remitted, until today I have received further 6,800 pounds, which has also been arranged to be remitted. But still, Mu'mineen have all not contributed, and there cannot be any imagination, safe and fair estimate of the requirement that is needed for helping those Mu'mineen who are fighting ceaselessly and who are either wounded or require food. And even those places which have been devastated by war are places where there is not a morsel of food available for the population. Whatever we give is inshallah ta'ala عند الله مقبول, Allah will accept. Before I go to the masail, I have been requested to also tell Mu'mineen to return the forms of power gen shares which they had filled, and now it is required, if the allocation has been made to them, to return the forms duly signed, because that money, which will be inshallah accrued from these forms, will go to pay off the debt of this Imam Bar. Mu'mineen, therefore, I know that in Rosa we do become a bit lazy, but shun some laziness and let us work. Just two signatures in return of Jamaat, inshallah ta'ala. About the masail of Rosa, we have come to a stage where there are certain things which have got to be explained. We were discussing about traveling during Mahe Mubarak Ramadan. It must be clear now that according to Ayatollah Al-Khoi, the order for a large city, a big city, and a small one is the same as far as Qasr or Safar is concerned. A city as big as London or a Tehran or Karachi or Bombay has the same order as any small town as far as Safar is concerned, and therefore those who work within London, as long as they are within London, it may be even traveling and commuting up to 25 or 28 or 29, 30 miles, as long as they are within London, according to Ayatollah Al-Khoi, they are not travelers. So therefore many Mu'mineen have asked that early in the morning as they rise, they have got to go for work, say about 20 miles away, but within London. If it is within London, then of course they are not musafir, they are not travelers. They will fast and there will be no namaz al-qasr for them. According to Ayatollah Al-Khoi, those who in taqlid of Ayatollah Khomeini, rahmatullah alayh, if they are still in continuous taqlid of him, must refer to his risala, because he had given a fatwa that Safar will begin from home when the distance is more than 14 miles one way, even within the city, provided the city is big. But as far as Ayatollah Khomeini is concerned, the city, big or small, is no difference. Those salesmen who have to travel out of London, if it is as frequent as daily, then they are not travelers, they will fast. But those who go once a week, or sometimes twice in a fortnight, or twice in a month, or maybe even more, four or five times in a month, they will break the fast if they go beyond the hadd tarakhus, and if they don't live there for 10 days or more, and if they leave London, the hometown, whatever which your town be, before Zuhr. After Zuhr, there is no question. Those students who live here, they are not living in a watan. They must remember this. Students who come from abroad to study, say, in London, in Sheffield, or Suffolk, or New York, or anywhere they go, they are there, although they may live there for 1 year, 2 years, even 5 years for study, but they are not mutawattin, they are not in watan. They must remember this. So what will happen? As long as they are there studying and living, of course, they are praying full. But if they are traveling, say, to a place and come back temporarily for a day or two and then traveling again, if they are not at any given time staying in that place for more than 10 days or 10 days, they will pray qasr and they will not fast because they are not mutawattin. They should remember this. Watan you can have more than one, provided you make a niyyah that this is my watan. But the boy or the girl has come to study. It is not a watan. Watan you can have as many as you want, but if it is not a watan, watan has got a condition where man must have got his properties and must have lived for at least 6 months on end and must have made a niyyah to live there. But coming to London to study for 5 years, 8 years, even 10 years, if he goes from London to Birmingham, from Birmingham he comes to London for 2 days and goes to Peterborough, for those 2 days in London he will pray qasr, and if he is in Ramadan he will not fast. Therefore, must be very careful that watan is the criteria. The mas'ala which was also very important was about remaining in janabat up to morning. If anyone purposely remains in janabat without doing ghusl till subh sadiq, I said this, his roza will be batil. Please let us be careful about it. Anyone who has got janabat ghusl wajib at night has got to be careful that he does his ghusl, her ghusl, before subh sadiq, that is before fajr. And if there is a lady in her period who is becoming clean, then that night she will have to perform her ghusl haid before fajr. Now there are two things I would like to clarify tonight, the rest inshallah later. One, suppose a lady who intended to have ghusl before fajr woke up right at the time when there is only 2 minutes or 3 minutes left for fajr. Now she cannot go for ghusl. If she goes for ghusl, the time of fajr will enter. For such a lady who knows for certain that there is no time left now for ghusl, she did not do it purposely, she slept. Sleeping is allowed. She had an intention that she will do ghusl, but she overslept. And as she woke up, she sees the time is about 5 minutes, she cannot take her ghusl. For such a lady, it is wajib to do tayammum, tayammum badle ghusl. Tayammum in place of ghusl. And having done that, her roza will be sahih and she will pray. Of course, afterwards, in the daytime, anytime, she will do her ghusl before next namaz. And tayammum is a simple procedure which I believe is wajib for me to explain. According to Ayatullah Al-Khui, you don't need anything but sand, dust or stone. These are in priorities, but sand is first priority. And sand is available in England. You can have them from seashores. It is available. That is the first thing. Sand, and we must keep it at home the way we keep watch over water tape. There must be at least one small bag containing sand. God knows when we may need tayammum. Tayammum on sofa set, tayammum on cushions, tayammum on carpet is not permissible, as many people believe that dust particle is enough. According to Ayatullah Al-Khui, it is not enough. It is the last thing. If nothing is available, then sofa sets or dust particles accumulated on carpets can be used. Otherwise, there must be sand or dust. It must be dry, not wet, no mud. And once having spread, it is wajib to strike. To strike is wajib. Not only to touch, to strike. With a niyat first, that I am doing it in lieu of, say, ghusl, ghusl haid, janabat, whatever, qurbatan ilallahi ta'ala, and strike. After having struck, then you dust off. And then with this palm, part of the palm, the end of the palm, you begin from where the hair grows. Yeah. Covering your forehead up to the nose tip and up to here. Again I do it. That is enough. Then from the wrist, after having removed all those rings or bangles or whatever you have, from the wrist goes right hand first and then left, and this tayammum is ready, and it is the easiest way of falling within time because it doesn't take longer, and according to Ayatullah Hui, you don't require a second striking even if tayammum is for ghusl. Once having struck is enough. This is wajib. I say this because we cannot play about with roza. If a man has got fear of God and knows that he is answerable and accountable to his deeds tomorrow, we must know that if we are not going to do according to what he has told us, there will be a kafara and no waris, no waris. There are waris who will at least pay for qaza namaz. No waris is going to pay for kafaras, because that is the most difficult part in one's life. Please do not let us enter into kafara for deliberately breaking the fast. Even ghusl janabat, if one rises and finds that there is no time, he slept, and now the only 5 minutes are left, he will do tayammum. And badla tayammum, badla ghusl here, after him then tayammum, he will fast. Fasting will be valid. This is necessary to say. The rest masail are many. I will continue inshallah ta'ala. The subject that we have been discussing, which is very important now, within 15 minutes I would like to complete it, if I can, is what I said last time about having understood that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills is done. What He wills is done. Mashiyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we must be clear in our minds that whatever happens in our life happens according to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether one likes it, does not like it, whether one believes in it, does not believe in it, there is an unseen hand which guides the destiny of all of us. The only thing required of a Muslim is that he should have that faith that I have reposed my destiny in the hand of one who is not only merciful, but is also wise. You don't know, perhaps, how many people, ladies and gents, in the Ummah of Islam, Shia and non-Shia, are today suffering from nervous tension and breakdown. How many? Numberless people. Only those will know to whom reference is being made. And I only say this because when things are referred, we naturally like to tell the person to talk about what he has got. What is the problem? And we find that the problem is common. There is no one here sitting who will say that my problem is peculiar. Although everyone likes to feel that his problem is the most acute, but the problem is naturally common. All of us have nearly same problems. But someone comes and he is trying to prove to me that now he is breaking under the stress. Why is he breaking under the stress? After having gone deep into it and made a profound study, we came to a conclusion that what is missing is faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very important. Why have we lost sabr? Why have we lost patience? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to forbear, to be patient. Inshallah ta'ala, As you exercise sabr and patience, things will unfold themselves. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, he said in Najd al-Balagha something which is so apt. He said, if one becomes uneasy in sabr, then in shouting and crying, he will become all the more uneasy. Naturally, sabr is somewhere where you collect yourself, compose. And the Prophet himself, at the end, after 23 years of the problems that he faced, Quran says, Alam nashrah laka sadrak wa wada'na anka wizrak alladhi anqadha dhahrak wa rafa'na laka dhikrak. At the end, this is when everything is over, when the whole Arabia and beyond have become Muslims. Delegations after delegations coming to the Prophet, swearing oath of allegiance on his hand, accepting Islam. After all the problems and trouble and pains, the surah says, Alam nashrah laka sadrak, O Prophet, have we now not opened up your heart? Alam nashrah laka sadrak, wa wada'na anka wizrak, and we have removed that burden from your back. What burden? Alladhi anqadha dhahrak, such a burden which had actually bent you down. Such a heavy burden. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ, and now we have raised and elevated your name and your memory. And then there is a theory. Sometimes there are theories in Quran which must be compiled in a separate book. Only ulama have got to sit down and compile. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَى إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَى. O Muhammad, tell them all. After every adversity, there are easy days. After every adversity, there is a good day. After every, as they say, cloud has a silver lining. So, at the end of the tunnel, there is light. Inna ma'al usri yusra. This is what the Prophet was told. We have lost patience altogether. When we were young, we used to read one small lesson. There was a rabbit, upon his head fell one small seed from the heaven, somewhere. Not from the sky, but maybe the rabbit was just sitting somewhere in the tree and a small fruit fell on the head. And you know what he said? Doro doro akash tuti peru. Means run, all of you, because the heaven has fallen onto my head. It was a small fruit, but he felt that it was the whole sky which has fell over. We are nowadays living in this sort of environment where small adversity, bago bago akash tuti peru. You see, we have lost that patience to say, wait, inna ma'al usri yusra. For every adversity, there is something behind it which is called maslaha. And wait. There was a lady who came to Imam Ja'far Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, and said, in those days, of course, traveling was difficult, communication was also a problem. She said, my son has left for business for the last 1 year and has not come. There is no letter, there is no news. Ya Ibn Rasulillah, pray for his safe return. Imam alayhi salam said, inshallah, he will return, inshallah. You go home, you pray, because the prayer of mother for her children and the prayer of father for his son, Allah never returns back. Fine, she went and she prayed. 4 months elapsed and she came after 4 months. Said, Ibn Rasulillah, the boy has not turned up and there is no news. Said, wait, he will come. He will go. She went. After 2 months, she came back and said, Ibn Rasulillah, the boy has not come. Every time you are telling me to go home, I go. Having heard from you, I draw some solace from your word. But the boy has not turned up. I am the mother. Ya Ibn Rasulillah, what has happened to him? And she started weeping and crying. Said, now I cannot wait for a day. Imam al-Islam said, you go home and he will come tomorrow. And next morning, the boy came, knocked the door, and entered the house. And she was so delighted. She came to the Imam and said, Ya Rasulullah, the boy has come. How did you come to know? He said, in this there was no miracle, O mother. In this there was no miracle. It is sabr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a test for everyone. This is a link. When the link, even today, you take any link, any chain, when it becomes very tight, it breaks. Imam al-Islam said, when the link becomes extremely tight, it breaks. When the sabr reaches its brim, then it overflows. Since you said last night that I cannot tolerate, I told you, inshallah, faraj is near. You go home and you got your son. Let people understand that when some people come and say, Mulla sahab, ayya sudhi pochi gich. On the very second day that they see musibah, they say, I have reached here. It has not even reached here still. It has got to go up and up yet. But on the very first day, ayya sudhi avigyochu means what? Means I am not prepared to write. That is not the way we should live. We must try to see that there is some sabr. That is one thing. Second thing is that we have forgotten one thing in our lives. This is for young people also to understand. That whatever we get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my friends, is not by way of return of our deeds. It is by way of grace. Allahu Akbar. Many people believe that because I have prayed 2 rakat namaz, therefore Allah has given me. What sort of namaz was it? Allahu Akbar. That Russian bill I have forgotten. Yes. Qiraat, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Oh, what will I answer my wife? I haven't brought the fish.